Hello, Lantern Magician. I am Jay, your guide to cut through the hype and actually master your EOS M.
So this may look like a toy or maybe even your grandmother's first digital camera.
But make no mistake, now that you've installed Magic Lantern, this thing is officially a beast. One key difference between this and a purpose-built cinema camera like the ones you find on a big budget film set is the number of physical buttons. Expensive cinema rigs have almost every crucial function mapped to a dedicated button. Why? Because time is money, literally. When Tom Cruise is on set, every minute costs thousands of dollars. You can't afford to waste time digging through menus. But here's the thing, you are not on a film set, you are learning. You're going at your own pace, and for that, the EOS M is actually kind of perfect. Sure, the lack of physical buttons can seem like a limitation, but thanks to the improved Magic Lantern interface, it doesn't really matter that much. It isn't the cryptic, buggy mess from the early days. The menus are now surprisingly intuitive, almost like using a modern off-the-shelf camera. So in this episode, I'll walk you through the buttons that do exist, what they are good for, and how to quickly find your way around the menu. Let's dive in. Oh, and make sure to grab the free EOS M Blueprint Starter Kit. It's the companion guide for this whole series, and it's always kept up to date. Links in the description. All right, on top we have the shutter button, this mode selector ring. Next we have the on off button there, then the record button, the playback button, the menu button, and then we have this wheel, and in the middle of it a set button, and on the bottom there's the info button, and that's it. All right, on the side there we have a physical connector to the PC, ancient looking micro USB for firmware updates. Next to it is the HDMI mini out for monitors and transmitters, things like that. And then we have a 3.5 mic connector, which I use all the time. And if you're curious why I removed the flap, it's because I shoot all the time professionally and I just don't want to bother with flaps. And on the other side, there's nothing. Here we have the lens removal button, whatever it's called. And then this is an IR sensor. And with this remote there, it's absolutely life-saving sometimes if you want to start recording from a distance or if you record yourself. Great. And now that we are familiar with all of the physics of the camera, the outer layer, let's activate it. Let's flip to camera and see what is going on software wise. So firstly, you'll notice it takes maybe a second longer to load compared to the normal Canon menu. What I'm looking at there are the audio levels currently fed by the built-in mics. There's an indicator that we are shooting raw, temperature, frame rate, SD card storage that remains, bit information, mode, focal length. Next to that is the aperture, shutter speed, and ISO information, auto white balance. I don't really care about that because we can always set it later. And yes, manual focus, which is the way to go on this camera. So first of all, let's flip through the Canon menu, because in older builds, there were some things to be set in there. Very important to the operation. Not sure that's still the case. Just, I think, yeah, it used to be recommended this flexi zone thing, but it already has had it that way. So image stabilizer, I think we don't need. So ISO, all you have to make sure you don't want it to be on auto, because that will do your head in. Picture style, that's just for, you know, how it looks on the screen. This will not be recorded. I always have it in standard. That's kind of the, you know, most average looking way. frame rate, I think that is relevant. You kind of want it in this 24 setting there. As far as I know, that's what I put it to anyway. Okay, cool. Next, sound recording. This menu here will be of interest for anyone plugging in microphones, even if you use Magic Lantern, the Magic Lantern menu. I typically set my level in there. Next, formatting the card. Okay, so it says there that it will keep Magic Lantern. So that's a quick way to get rid of footage once you have it in your computer, made a backup and no longer need it. That's how you do it. That's one way to do it. And as you will see, touching the half shutter, Magic Lantern is still there. Okay, so it does not wipe the software, it just wipes the files, your footage. Okay, and I think we are almost done, yes, with our Canon menu. And now we shall get to the Magic Lantern menu here, to be found on the trash can. If you hold the trash can for a little while, then there it is, it opens up. And as you can see, this looks a little bit more complex than the stock Canon menu. There are all these pages at the top. Let's quickly, and as you can see, there's quite a lot of cryptic looking stuff going on, but we shall focus on the ones that are relevant to the beginner, starting with, well, white balance is actually not that relevant, because shooting raw, regardless of what you set it to, now it's set to auto, you can set it to anything we want, but actually that's only relevant to the preview, because at any point in the post process, you can change that to your heart's desire. So for instance, when this comes in handy, you just don't have time, you're a one-man show, you shoot different times of day, different locations, and you want an overall look on your product, then you can make a morning scene look like a midday scene, etc., etc. Okay, so there's your ISO. Pretty standard stuff. Next, dual ISO. I would recommend not to mess with that as a beginner. I think I'll make probably an extra video that basically can extend your dynamic range significantly, but it also comes with some problems. Next, we're in the overlay menu page, and here one thing I personally, you can put a lot of overlays here, whatever you want. Personally, I like to use the histogram, and here's the settings I set it to. And one part of that I like the most is this exposure to the right hint function, and it's there on the bottom now. You can see the waveform. So I do two things. I look at the waveform, making sure it kind of looks healthy, and now I'm increasing the ISO and to trigger it into, you know, giving me the warning that I'm overexposed now. So I added ISO. I could have added more light or increased the lens's aperture if that lens would allow me to. And then if it gets too bright, it gives you the warning that you're overexposed. And that's something you have to keep an eye on, because you can recover shadows on RAW quite a crazy amount, but on this particular camera, the recovering highlights is a bit of a problem. And in the same rain here is our zebra function. Can't really see it here because it's too bright on the camera that records the back of the screen. But there are some kind of lines that show you, okay, this area there is overexposed. False color is also available, but I rather use these on my external monitor. But for the beginner, everything is there you can wish for. Next, customize buttons. Very handy. Shall we look at that? Cool. As you can see, we don't have many buttons on the camera, but we can map certain functions that you find after using the camera for some time, or if you're an experienced cameraman, things that you know you want available quickly without going through the menu, you can map them. Like this focus 10x help thing there. So that allows me to razor like dial in the focus, which is harder when you have that little LED screen there. See, it's not really focused, but pressing the half shutter, I can dial it in perfectly. And I like to keep that on the half shutter. I assigned it to the half shutter, focus 8, there it is. And there's other things that you can do. I don't really understand what the difference is, but you know, maybe someone of you can let us know in the comments. So set button, I just never really use it. Info button, I set it to dual ISO. Just like I said, I wouldn't recommend using this as a beginner. There's a lot of things to have to learn before you can use that and really take advantage of it. Tab display, I like to keep off because sometimes when I'm running and gunning, I touch the screen and suddenly it does things I don't want it to do. Up and down arrows is ISO. More hex allow. Honestly, I don't know what that means, to be honest. So, and I think for me, we're sort of done. That's just my settings, and some people have it more advanced. So one other thing I would like you to show, if you have motorized lenses, you can hold the wheel like I do there, push it to the on the right side. And now you can use the wheel to change your aperture. Okay. And that's obviously for lenses with motors, like, you know, normal DSLR lenses. And between that and the up and down arrows, you have a quite powerful exposure tools right at your fingertips. So you don't have to dial in things flipping through the menu. You can do that on the fly. So obviously with manual lenses, you can, you know, just grab the lens and change the setting there. So sound recording, that sometimes can be interesting. Some people turn it off on certain modes to get extra, you know, the high speed mode, for instance, to get some extra performance. But I don't really ever touch it. I have not found the need to. So I think for the beginning, we are done here. Maybe the bitrate is worth mentioning still. I would recommend you to set it to 10. So if you start experimenting with modes and you have the recommended card, I can tell you off the bat that most of the modes are working continuously in 10-bit, but not so in higher bit rates. And it doesn't really make that much of a difference. I can tell you that. So there's a bit of a difference in the shadows. Some noise in the shadows might be better at higher bit rates, but you don't get like an incredibly much better image. So here, frame rates, I would stay away from 30. I can tell you that it's between 24 and 25. And oddly enough, let me tell you that the crazy thing about this camera, it doesn't really matter too much. I found you can be in Australia, you can be in Korea, you can be in Germany, in England, and they all have different, you know, recommended settings. 24, 25, one country has this. It's to do with your AC thing, but on this camera, it doesn't really seem to cause the flickering it does on other cameras. Here, I'm looking at the high FPS mode. I think it goes to like 56. I think I could push it, but there will be another video on that. But let me get back to the normal standard mode. Come on. Which is 1080p. That's your standard mode, which I would recommend you just to start experimenting with. Okay, I think we're pretty much through here on this page. Don't mess with the aspect ratio yet. That's a topic in and of itself. All right, just for fun, let's select a high resolution mode. And as you can see, this crops in quite significantly. All right, but you can also tell it's a lot crisper than the standard mode because it's like pixel by pixel. And here, by the way, I'm happy that happened. The screen goes black. Oh my God, the camera died or what? No, just touch the half shutter button and the black goes away. So if ever it goes black, that's what you do. All right, so let's record. And as you can see, even the high res mode works fine with 10 bit. And I just recorded this so I can show you the playback function there, okay? So I hit the playback button and there you can see it's playing it back frame by frame, super slow because it's a 12-year-old camera or something. So, and if you do what I just did there, touch the wheel and then set this thing from all to exact, it will skip frames so you can check your scene in a little bit more of a realistic time frame. Okay, but that's one of the limitations of the camera. So think of it like an old film camera that you can have some preview, but it's a little bit limited. So and the last thing we're going to discuss here is called peaking, but not the normal focus peaking. It's called slightly sharper. And I love that. It's on in my camera all the time. And as you can see, it artificially sharpens everything. But only the display. It's not being recorded. You see? So that allows me to not even have to use the focus aid or this 10 times zoom function. And I'm pretty accurate. Look at this. Now I'm zooming in. It's perfect. Almost perfect. Okay. So if you don't have time running around, running and gunning, this can be really, really handy. And turn it on, set it to slightly sharper. It's your friend. Personally, I'm not a big fan of conventional focus peaking, but that's just me. Great. So that is your peaking thing. Now let me reduce the ISO for a very quick demonstration of what I have mapped to the info button, just so you can see that it exists. Again, I would recommend not to use it in the beginner. That's what dual ISO looks like. So basically you get like one line is red at 100 ISO and the other you can set to say 800 or 1600. And then in some magical process, it will be combined later, but it's a sort of a topic in and of itself. So for now, don't use it. Okay. I just did it to show you. So now we've come a long way. We are back in the 1080 mode. Let's do another recording to show you one last thing. And that is another playback. And what you do if you have recorded multiple clips. So you'd spin the wheel and that was our high-res clip with the added crop. So that's how you flip through clips if you have recorded more than one. Okay, and that's our walkthrough coming to an end. So let's put on the kettle and have a cup of tea. All right, now you know your way around the buttons and menus. And you don't need to remember everything, just remember where to look. In the next video, we are going to record your very first RAW clip. That's where things get exciting and messy. Spoiler alert, you're probably going to screw it up. Which is a good thing, because that's where the real learning starts. Tutorials don't teach, doing does. And my job, making sure you mess up in all the right ways. We'll cover how to actually record, what settings matter, and how to not panic when things go wrong. So yeah, get ready, it's time to roll your first shot.